Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. A very good evening to everyone that is here right now. Thank you so much for coming. We appreciate your attendance. The reason why we kind of started a bit late is because there was a bit of a typo in our email invitations. It states that 205 instead of 250. So there may be some people that are a bit lost, and we apologize because that was a mistake on our part. So we are still waiting for some of them to come. So I'm so sorry, that's my phone.
Have you posted a correction on Facebook?
Yeah, but we posted the right one, so hopefully...
Right now
we've rectified the mistake, so hopefully more are going to come soon. But we appreciate you for coming and taking the time. I know it's easy to pay. And thank you so much for coming. Your attendance means a lot to us, significantly because we are applying for a grant. And that grant specifically says that if people do attend to our event, then we will get more people to come and people will show that they care about us. And yeah, that is a good reflection on our part. And hopefully we will be successful in getting the grant. Right now, for today, we welcome you to our second Heart Talk session, fifth event overall. The first one was with Rafizi Ramli. You guys may have went to that event. And this is our second one with YB Liew Chin Tong. And we are very, very appreciative of him coming solely for us, coming to Melbourne. Thank you so much, YB, for coming. He's an MP for Kluang, Johor, and a Central Executive Committee as a political education director for Democratic Action Party, DAP. And he's here solely because of us, so thank you so much again. And to help us on this issue of race-based politics, which I think is something that hits a bit too close to home. Everyone is pretty much familiar with the topic, and I think that's exactly why we think it's important to address this issue. And to help address this issue, we have Hamid Rahim, which is our co-president of Malaysia Progressive in Australia. So if you guys could help me welcome the two, and we will get started.
Thank you to my behalf for the kind description and introduction for us. A bit about YB Liew Chin Tong. He was the graduate. He graduated from ANU, where he studied political science and honours in Asian Studies. His rise in political scene in Malaysia is very impressive. You ask me why. In 2008, he won the first. This is the first time where he was elected in the parliament in the constituency of Balik Pulau. Bukit Bendera dan Balik Pulau. In 2013, he won again, but this time around is in Kluang, which people know is a stronghold of the ends. So very impressive state lah. And also, if you follow his political projection in 2013, he during the internal DAP party's election, he received the most votes in the position for Central Executive Committee, where he beat the people that he beat include the party advisor Limkit Sula. Sufficient opportunity to ask question to YB Liew. So YB is very kind, has agreed for our interview to be based around the topic of can we ever depart from race-based politics in Malaysia. So let us begin without further delay. So basically YB, I think an observation that we can make, and I think we all can agree, after the 13th general election, we have witnessed the rise of right-wing politics, group that advocate for right-wing politics. And they are very powerful. They are able to attract prominent leaders to join them. For example, Tan Sri Rahim Noor, which is the ex-IGP of Malaysia, is one of the members of PERKASA. Also, Tun Hamid Omar, which is the former Chief Justice of Malaysia, and at some point, Tun Mahathir is their patron. And as maybe we can say that they have been successfully lobbied for the Maintenance of Sedition Act and also to put on hold the Racial Harmony Bill, and the latest they blocked meaningful progress on the discussion on the introduction of the local election, local government election. So my question to you, YB, why why do you think this trend is happening, and why is it happening soon after the 2013 election?
I think first of all, it didn't happen after 2013 election. It happened after 2008.
Okay.
Essentially, I think all this move happened immediately after 2008. And 2008 election was very clear. There were three different arena in Malaysian politics. One, which was championed by Berseh, democratization. Berseh symbolizes democratization. And over that, I think since 2005, we have been talking about electoral reform, been talking about Berseh, and that was a platform that actually BN knew that it favors the opposition. The other area is actually the economy, whether the economy favors a certain group of people or actually whether it helps the ordinary Malaysians. I think that somehow BN also found that it favors the opposition. There's only one area which UMNO thrives. That is race, religion, royalty. So I call it the 3 R.
Yeah.
Pergauman, agama, and raja-raja. So these are this is the area where UMNO can find itself relevant, and they continue to play on it in the hope that they can maintain power forever. So I think UMNO draws its legitimacy from race, religion, and royalty. And therefore, they continue to place it. And I think after the last election, everyone find that they are lost, were stuck. After the last election, Barisan Nasional found that their model would not be able to continue. Whereas the opposition also find it very difficult to continue. were stuck. So over the last 2 years, the only way for UMNO to stay relevant is number one, keep on playing race cards, and number two, to try to destroy the opposition, and that's what has been happening over the last 2 years.
What would you think the proper response for Pakatan? Why do you find it very difficult to bring the politics to the middle ground?
I think broadly in Malaysia, we have to deal with this major problem of identity politics. Not only in Malaysia, but everywhere. I mean, here we're also facing identity politics on a daily basis. But I think, first of all, we have to understand that race is a social construct. Race is not biological. But in Malaysia, it's constructed as if it's biological. So that is one area that we have to deal with. The second area that we have to deal with is, I think, we have to deal with how to redefine our discourse and also identity. Mahathir tried it quite successfully. Now, for instance, when you're here, you call yourself Malaysian, you don't call yourself Chinese, Indian, Malays. But in Malaysia, there was a period of time when Mahathir found that he would lose power if there's a split among the Malay votes and all the non-Malays voted opposition. That was in the 1990 election. In the 1990 election, Mahathir suddenly found that if there is a challenge from a credible Malay opposition, at that time it was Tunku Razali in the form of Semangat 46, and with the non-Malay votes voting overwhelmingly for the opposition, UMNO would fall. Immediately after the 1990 election, the 1990 election happened in October 1990. In February 1991, Mahathir came up with this thing called Vision 2020. Some of you may be too young to remember that, but some of you have experienced that. From 1991 to 2005, when Hisham waved the kris, I think 2005, when Hisham waved the kris, it was a symbolic break of that 14 years of Vision 2020 politics. What was Vision 2020? Vision 2020 essentially means that if you are non-Malays and if you are rich, you can go to private school, the government won't stop you. If you are Chinese or an Indian, you want to watch Mandarin news, Mandarin TV, Cantonese TV, you want to watch Tamil TV, you can pay for Astro. You can do anything as long as you have money. You can have your cultural rights as long as you pay for it. And over that period of time, UMNO continues to operate in the same way. It always needed an enemy.
Yeah.
But over that period of 14 years, when UMNO needed enemy, or needed an imaginary opponent. It was not the Chinese. That 14 years, Mahathir went around the world to search for enemy. So Mahathir was anti-US, anti-Australian, anti-Jews. Mahathir was talking about the, who else? Singaporeans, the most convenient target. But rarely there was ethnic conflict. Over that 14 years, over that period of 14 years, there was a race riot in Kampung Medan, 2000. There were two or three issues where the ethnic Chinese didn't feel very happy. But over a period of 14 years, they were relatively non-racial. And that 14 years period, Mahathir received more votes from the non-Malays than the Malays. And in 1999, Mahathir was saved by the non-Malay support. So we have experienced that shifting identity. But 2005, UMNO went right-wing. And since then, I think they've gone further right.
So it seems to me that you are suggesting that it is UMNO BN that is trying to play the racial card. So but when, for the point of view of Raya, like me, when I see PR, the complete parties are DAP, PAS, and PKR. It's just a same mold, if I can say, that's a different level. DAP is a party that is mainly dominated by the Chinese, PAS by Malay, PKR maybe is specific case, but still dominated by Malay. So similar race-based political structure. So what does PR have something different to offer?
Yeah, I think previously, say for instance, before 1999, before UMNO was sacked, before 98, DAP was confined to mainly Chinese urban support, whereas PAS was confined to mainly rural Malay support in the northern states. But I think Reformasi changed everything. Reformasi changed everything. Immediately after UMNO was sacked, within a year, PAS doubled its membership. They were printing membership card on a daily basis, on a 24/7 basis. And to a large extent, DAP has also changed since Reformasi. At one point, we were just appealing to ethnic Chinese, Chinese-speaking Chinese. That was the hardcore ground, and especially those who are poor. But gradually, I think over the last 15 years, DAP has moved to has become the largest Indian party, having more Indians representing DAP than MIC, and also having ventured out to reach out to more to try to be a more Malaysian party. That I think is a progress. Within past, I think over the last 16, 17 years since Reformasi, they have been struggling with this whole trouble of whether to remain as a party true to the heartland in Kelantan, Terengganu, or to be a Malaysian party, a PAS that is for all. I always say that within PAS there's this conflict between those who think that PAS stands for what they call PAS Ganti UMNO, ataupun PAS untuk semua. And then these are two conflicting ideas, whether you want to replicate UMNO's ideas or you want to actually create a new base. So there are people who are responding to it, to UMNO structure, sometimes by constraint because you have no way to reach out, the only way is to survive. But I think there are more and more people who believe that PR as a whole has a chance to reach out to more people and reinvent the structure. I mean, we tried in many ways. For instance, when we came up with common policy framework, that was an attempt to focus on democracy, focus on democratization, focus on the economy, and not to focus on identity politics. So I think these are all the elements that happened.
I have a question because you bring out DAP. I agree with you when you say that DAP's political project has all about Malaysia, and now Middle Malaysia. But my point is, my question is, if you see the membership of DAP, only two MPs are from the Malay ethnic. One of the Malay MP is half Chinese, and one is Dr. Arif Sabri from Birao. So do you think that DAP political project is being accepted by Malaysia as a whole, becoming the Malay majority?
I think DAP and PAS has a similar problem. Among the non-Malays, they see PAS with fear. Among the Malays, they see DAP with fear. And in many ways, I think fear is the governing factor in Malaysia. Fear is the governing factor in Malaysia, and because DAP and PAS used to represent the underclass of their respective community. Now, PAS represent the independent farmers who are not rich but not dependent on the government. In an interesting comparison, I say PAS and DAP, well, most people say that PAS and DAP are totally different. But I think if you look at the sociological structure of these two parties, they are a mirror reflection. Before 98, at the bottom of PAS, the memberships are mostly independent farmers, small traders, small Malay traders in the kampung. They are not taking anything from the government, and they are pious, they are angry at the government, and they join PAS. At the top, they are mostly ulamas. In DAP, before 98, most of DAP's members were hawkers. Hawkers, if you imagine it in a different way, they are urban subsistence farmers because they may not have the right skill set to be in the formal employment. They may not have the what they call the opportunity to actually gain access to wealth. But they became hawkers because that's the only way. They are in a way subsistence farmer of sort in the urban areas. So, and at the top of DAP, at one point, they were mostly lawyers. And these lawyers were independent lawyers. They don't depend on the government. They are like the ulama in the kampung, who are not dependent on the government. So two parties representing, in many ways, representing the underclass of their respective constituents eventually had to come together. There are people who look at the commonality, there are people who look at the differences. And of course, the differences are always amplified because the media does not belong to you. And the media would want to exaggerate the differences in order for you to break, for you to remain in your home ground, and for you to continue, for PAS and DAP to continue to remain in their comfort zone. Reaching out, always carry risks, and in an environment where the government controls the media, the government amplified the differences with fear, by instilling fear, it's always difficult to reach out. But I think we all should learn from the failed project of PAS, I would call it. PAS attempted to be a national party quite successfully. In the last election, actually, PAS received huge number of non-Malay support. Their Malay support did not increase, but did not fall, apart from Kedah. PAS failed miserably in Kedah, but in other states, their Malay support remained stagnant, but did not actually decrease. And in fact, in Terengganu, because of the former MB's factor, their Malay votes actually increased by 3 or 4%. But they increased their non-Malay support to an unprecedented level. Now, the moment if this thing crossed, if non-Malays can accept PAS, and at the same time Malays can accept DAP, when this thing crossed, there would not be Barisan Nasional. Barisan Nasional will fall. But of course, it all depends on what happened at the Muktamar. It all depends on what happened at the Muktamar. And if the Muktamar cannot change the way things happen, things work in PAS, then we may have to think out of the box and to see how to realign the forces in Malaysian politics.
So do you think that PAS, in its current form, is not suitable for any coalition with DAP?
I think that PAS is, okay, for those who do not know, I actually did a thesis at ANU on PAS. I look at the differences within PAS around the time of 2001 and 2003, and looking at how within the party, there were people who wants to see PAS as a as the, what they call, democratic force, part of the democratic forces in Malaysia. But also some people would think that PAS is only for an exclusively defined group of Muslim, the most pious group of Muslim. That's the difference within PAS. There are people within PAS who think that they should reach out and they should actually eventually become part of the new government. There are people who think that, forget it, whether we win power or not, our jobs in politics is to is answerable to God and not voters. So that's the difference within PAS. And that difference, that cleavage within PAS has been there since 1999. Since 1999, and it has been continuously being played out within PAS. And at some point, I think that has to settle. At some point, I think it will come to a clash, and it's coming to a major clash now. And you don't know which way forward.
Yeah, I have a question, because you talk about how PAS try to reach the broader audience of Malaysia. I also see there's a similar trend in DEP.
Yes.
You will see last year they tried to advance Diana Sophia as a candidate for MP for Telok Intan. And we see there is a emergence of young Malay women that suddenly joined DEP, Rara, and also Melati, the one who wears the burqa. So, do you think after that project, is there any increase of a support from Malay or?
I think their increasing acceptance of DAP. Slow, very slow, but I think today more and more Malays are looking at DAP as an option. Partly because PAS is no longer seen as an option for the moment. For many people who wants to be in the opposition, who share the view that there's no way that we should support UMNO. I think those people are now looking at DAP as a potential option. Still difficult, for many Malays it's still very difficult to accept DAP. But increasingly, I think those people who might have joined PAS, or who are already in PAS and found that the party somehow has lost its bearing, are now looking at DAP as a potential option. I think it's difficult. I mean, it's a difficult project. It's a difficult project because that requires a reimagination of DAP self-identity, and also they require a realignment of the political forces. But I think there may be realignment of the political forces in Malaysia. Well, let me put it this way. In 1999, it was like an earthquake. 98-99, when Anwar was sacked, there was a new party called Parti Keadilan. Came out of nowhere, but they recruited people from UMNO, from ABIM, who were formerly not in the political process, but they were activists, but not in any political party. They also recruited NGOs, members of the NGOs, into Keadilan. And as I pointed out earlier, in 99, there was also 400,000 Malay Muslims who hated Mahathir at the time, but not trusting Anwar enough, and they decided not to join PKR, they joined PAS. So at that point of time, I say it was an earthquake, new forces emerged, and there was a realignment in 99. I think we have come to a stage where realignment has to happen. Realignment has to happen in what way, I do not know. And I think we have 2 years has passed since the last election. If you are sitting in UMNO's war room, you'll be very worried about the next election. You're not sure which way to go. Likewise, I think people in Pakatan are also worried which way the politics will go.
Yeah. I just want to bring back the issues of the DAP trying to reach out to the Malay voters. Don't you think that by bringing these three urban, young, attractive women can be seen by some cynical to be in a desperate act to attract people from the Malay? Because in my opinion, you see that most of the urban Malay already voted for the DAP anyway. So how by introducing Melati, who live in city, can suddenly increase the support in the places where the Malay is still suspicious to the DAP?
I think we did not actually, what they call, publicize their entry. It was Malaysia Kidney who chose to publicize their entry, their joining of the AP initially. And of course, we are happy that more and more people are joining the AP, that is for sure. We are happy about it. But it wasn't intentional to just to focus on these three women. I think it's giving the wrong impression just to focus on women. And I think it's not the right thing that we want to do. But eventually, I think the message is very clear that the DAP doesn't want to stay at the corner. The DAP wants to be a national party. The DAP wants to be a party that everyone finds it comfortable to be within the family. And I think DAP also has to come to understand that we are no longer dealing with just the urban non-Malay constituencies.
Yeah.
The 2013 election was interesting for DAP. For the first time, we had the Kadazan reps. For the first time, we venture into and won many seats that are semi-urban. We used to be only confined to the urban areas. But this round, we were able to win many semi-urban seats. And in those semi-urban seats, I think the future of Malaysian politics and the future of Pakatan politics is very much determined by semi-urban seats in the peninsula. Now, for let's say Sabah Sarawak will have a different set of dynamics, but in the peninsula, Malaysian politics will be decided in the semi-urban seats. Why I say so? Imagine where Pakatan lost marginally. Pakatan lost marginally in Southern Kedah, east of Prince of Wales. the provincial of Sabrang. East of Sabrang, northern Perak, to that belt, Penang, Southern Kedah, northern Perak. That is one belt that Pakatan lost a few seats. Lost a few seats that we won in 2008. In Southern Perak, northern Selangor, that was also an area where we failed to win. You can imagine, think about places like Tanjung Malim, Telok Intan. On the Perak side, Bagan Dato on the Perak side, and on the Selangor side, Kuala Selangor, Sungai Besar, Hulu Selangor, Kuala Selangor. So those are the areas, another cluster of seats where we failed to win. And there's a further area which is northern Johor, Muar, Ledang, Segamat, Labis. So those are cluster of seats where, and also in Pahang. Those are seats where we could have won and we failed to win. Cameron Highland,
Bentong.
So in those areas, and there are about 30 of them. If we have won these 30 seats, it would be very different. But I think this is where we have to, as a whole, the coalition has to reach out to people in those areas. And this is where both DAP and Pakatan has to understand semi-urban areas, has to reach out to semi-urban areas, has to convince the semi-urban areas that a Pakatan government is not a government of non-Malays. And those are the areas where information are lacking. I'll give you an example why on the part of Pakatan we have to learn the lesson of 2013. Is that if you remember our signature policies, Turun Harga Kereta, Hapus Kantong,
Abolish
PTPTN, Turun Harga Minyak. Now these are the signature policies. Imagine that you are a motorcyclist, a Malay motorcyclist in the semi-urban areas, working in the agriculture sector or plantation sector. Turun harga kereta, aku tak ada kereta. Turun harga minyak, motor is not going to consume, motorcycle is not going to consume a lot of petrol. PTPTN, I don't even finish Form 3. What more about PTPTN? It has nothing to do with me. Motorcyclist doesn't have to pay toll. So I think the 2013 election, Pakatan was essentially an urban phenomenon.
Urban chauvinist.
Okay, maybe. I mean, we have to learn our lesson, and then we have to be frank about it. I think we can be very frank about it now that we are back to the drawing board. We are thinking about realignment, and we have to be frank with ourselves. So moving forward, I think we have to understand semi-urban areas, and we have to understand people who are not well off, people who are struggling, the struggling families, especially the struggling Malay families. And in semi-urban areas, it is where race becomes very salient. Why race becomes salient? Because in most semi-urban areas, the small traders, the employers, are usually non-Malays. The employers are non-Malays, particularly Chinese. The employees are either foreign workers or Malays. Now, both actually are stuck. The small businesses in the semi-urban areas are not doing well because there's no policy that helps them to transform. There's no way for them to transform. There's no way for them to upgrade. And the only subsidy that the government is giving to the small businesses are foreign workers. You can hire cheap foreign workers, and that's the only subsidy the government is giving to this industry. And why is the government so willingly importing cheap foreign labor for this industry? Because for every foreign workers that comes into this country or comes into Malaysia, someone make a cut somewhere. But for the Malaysian economy to grow, it is about having less labor, but better paid, better skilled labor. Now, that is not being looked at. So I think we have to find a way to convince the semi-urban voters, in particular Malay voters in those areas, that a change of government means better economic life. And so that they are not susceptible to the idea that when you have a change of government, it means DAP taking over alone, it means Chinese dominance. I think this is not the ideas that we stand for, and we have never stand for ethnic politics.
But can I just conclude the fact that the rise of a racial politics in non-urban and semi-urban state happens more aggressively because of PR failure to be in touch with the current issue of the rakyat in the semi-urban state?
I think on the one hand, I think that may be right. On the other hand, BN also knows that that's the only way they can survive, and they put a lot of effort into it. And that has always been their stronghold. This is for the first time we are challenging those strongholds. This is for the first time we are challenging. And in those areas, UMNO is not just the party. UMNO is the government. UMNO comes with KEMAS, with JASA, with all the government institutions campaigning for them. And I mean, for Pakatan to win 52% of votes in the election, that is an impressive record. But failure to win those seats either means that we failed, or we have yet to actually do well in those areas. And I think we should focus on winning support. So
I think the reason why the BN government focusing on the racial issues is because, as you can see, racial card is more effective to be played in the non-urban and semi-urban areas. And judging on the, if you look at the election map in Malaysia, most of the seats coming from the non-urban and semi-urban area. So don't you think, what is PR's plan? The issue of gerrymandering has been one of the main causes why BN is very difficult to topple the current government. So what is the effort of the PR to ensure that the next delineation of the electoral map will be fair?
I think it's, of course, there are two parts, I'll answer in two parts. One is that it is very difficult to determine, to ensure that the electoral process or the redemination process will be free and fair. I think it's very difficult. And part of the reason why UMNO is manipulating the differences within PAS is also because they know that they need an additional 14 seats, 14 votes, when it comes to constitutional amendment. We have 222 seats in the parliament. 148 is the threshold for constitutional amendment, the two-thirds majority. Barisan Nasional has 134 seats after Teluk Intan. They won 133 seats in the last election. After Tu Lin Tan, they have 134 seats. They are short of 14 votes to have a free hand to increase the number of seats in parliament. And there were proposals floating around that we heard of. Basically, they want to increase 40 seats in the parliament in order to for them to have an advantage in winning government. So one of the reasons why UMNO spending so much time to court the conservative in the past is partly for this purpose. So it's difficult to ensure that. But I also think that if Pakatan can find a formula, or an expanded Pakatan, a realigned Pakatan can find a formula to win the hearts and minds of Malaysians in semi-urban areas, especially the ethnic Malays in semi-urban areas, then however you read it in it, you are not going to get anywhere. That is, if the opposition parties combined can receive, say, 45 to 50% of Malay support, with huge, overwhelming support from the rest, then however you play with the boundaries, yeah, it won't work.
Yeah. Just so that I don't understand you wrongly, so are you saying that the reason BN support Hudud is an exchange for PAS to support the new regeneration map?
I'm saying that one of the reasons why, to a certain extent, one of the reasons, not the only reason, the other reason is to break Pakatan for UMNO to court the conservative in PAS. Eventually, the purpose is to break Pakatan. But breaking Pakatan will bring them the numbers, sufficient number to change the constitutions. If you follow Dr. Zudi's writing, that's the game. If you can change the boundary, then you can increase the number of seats. Therefore, game over for whoever wants to have a different form of governance. So I think that is the game plan. But the other part of it is that I think BN is losing ground from among the semi-urban areas, mainly because of economic reasons. Before the GST was implemented, the argument goes like this. MCA will go around to tell the Chinese the GST is good. Why is the GST good? Because GST, for the first time, forces the Malays to pay tax. That's the argument, huh? That's the argument that MCA spread. This is for the first time Malays will have to pay tax, because Malays have never paid tax. That's the argument, how it goes. UMNO's argument is basically, this is a good tax, because for the first time, the Chinese businesses, and all Chinese businesses are evading tax, they are all evil people, and for the first time, the evil Chinese businesses will be forced to pay tax. No, that's the argument. Ahmad Maslan has been selling those things. The moment GST came, suddenly everyone found that whether you're Malay, Chinese, Indian, you all have to pay tax. Everyone has to pay tax, and eventually it goes to the government coffer. Now, why is GST being such a major, being talked about by everyone? Partly because most Malaysians have not paid tax. Not just the Malays. Many do not pay tax. And how do you know that many Malaysians do not pay tax? You just have to look at the numbers of people who receive BRIM. Right, BRIM recipients, more than 60% of the populations are receiving BRIM, the One Malaysia, what they call it, assistance program. Why do you receive BRIM? You receive BRIM because you're poor. Of course, the government wants to buy water. But 60% of the population, or more than that, of course, they're double counting on this, but essentially, 60% of the population are living with a monthly wage of less than 3,000 or less than 4,000. Monthly family income of less than 4,000. The moment you introduce a new tax on those people, you are taking away disposable income from them. You are taking away whatever they have. And the impact is so strong because so many people are living in that category of below 4,000 ringgit family income. And many of them are actually below 2,000. So that the impact is huge. Further, over the last 10 years, since 2003, since the Iraq War, essentially, since the Iraq War, petrol price and palm oil prices has been quite high. Only until recently that they came down. Of course, when petrol price came down, palm oil prices also came down. Petrol is important to the government coffer. Palm oil is politically salient. Palm oil is politically very salient in Malaysia. Where are the semi-urban areas? The semi-urban areas are where feldas are. What does felda do? 90% of felda is involved in palm oil. Some are involved in rubber, but those who are involved in rubber are quite a minority. Majority of them are involved in palm oil. And when palm oil prices are low for a long period of time, and when the government collects GST to buy private jet, you can imagine how it goes on the ground. So I think those part, the economic part, if eventually it's being articulated properly and not falling into a racial argument, if we can find a way to articulate something that brings everyone together, then I think BN will be in a very difficult position.
This will be my last question before I open it to the floor, after that we continue again. So there is a recent survey that has been published by the Merdeka Center of Review, Merdeka Center Review. Very promising. It stated that 76 of Malaysians reject racist politics. But if you break down the numbers more deeper, you will see that if you break down based on race, 30% of the Malays have a suspicion on a multiracial political project. Only 8% and for Chinese and 11% for the Indian who have a suspicion on a multiracial political project. My question is, why do you think that the suspicion to depart from race-based politics is overwhelmingly coming from the Malay?
I think we're living in a country where the, as I say, the governing factor is fear. Chinese fear the Malays. The Malay fears the Chinese, and we are always in this being told that, oh, someone is still going to take away something from you. You're always constantly living in those conditions, and especially for people who have less access to internet, who do not have information, and who only follows government propaganda. There's no surprise that more Malays are in that sort of fear. The fear of losing something, the fear of losing dominance, and sometimes it's not about dominance. I think many people think that the Malay project is a project of dominance. I think it's not. Malays support a Malay project out of fear of being taken, Malaysia being taken over by the non-Malays, Malaysia being governed by people who are alien to us. It's the fear of the other. And I think Pakatan has a lot of work to do. It's not easy, or those who want to see a better Malaysia has a lot of work to do, to reassure everyone that non-race-based politics is a project that unites everyone, that on the basis of trust, without fear. And then how to take away the fear factor, how to reassure people, how to build trust, I think that is something that we have to work
but
on.
I don't think that you can entirely blame the Malay conservative, I mean, because DAP has been that they're indicating that they are against a special position to be given to a specific race. And some say that they don't just say that DAP is anti-Malay, but anti-constitution, or even anti-religion. So, what can you think DAP can do in order to detach from this label?
I think, of course, all this has historical, everyone has historical baggage, and it comes with a context of a different time. I think for the DAP and for Pakatan, not just the DAP, it is about building a narrative that is actually for the 90%. I think we have been talking about meritocracy, and we have been talking about getting helping the best.
I'm just going to make the question very specific. Yeah. What do you think about Article 153?
Well, I think we are okay with it. And we have, in our numerous meeting, we have reaffirmed our agreement on that. So I think 153 is not a major problem. The major problem, the fear comes from people thinking that, oh, the moment DAP takes over, you're only going to have the best. But we are not the best. And this is not just among the Malays. So I think the discourse of meritocracy has to somehow be moderated with the discourse of solidarity, with the discourse of looking at the 90%. How do you help the 90% to live a better life and not just focusing on the best? The talk of the best is, yeah, of course, we are losing talent, we are losing, but we have to always be able to articulate something that is for everyone. Once you can articulate something based on the idea of solidarity, based on the ideas of a better nation for everyone, and so that you have a rising tide for all, I think then you can moderate the image that you're only for the best. And the whole idea of meritocracy has always been given a racial tone by our opponent. And well, the moment you say the best means you're only helping the non-Malays, I think that discourse has to change.
Okay, we're accepting question now. Okay, I got one, Dinesh. Two. First three. Jason, you're late. Okay. Okay, Dinesh. Yep.
Why did you?
Just call me Chin Tong.
Yeah, your name and also where you're working on, student from any university.
Okay, my name is Dinesh, and I'm from Tindak, Malaysia. And for me, the topic about gerrymandering and malapportionment is a very big thing. I know it is a tough battle, but it's an issue that we cannot afford to ignore anymore. Because in Sarawak, EC is effectively contempt of court of proceeding with a second redelineation. So I know for sure it is very hard to change EC's attitude at this present moment. And DAP and PKR in Sarawak is very firm, you know, that we are not going to let EC out the loose. But in my opinion, that in order to fight gerrymandering and malapportionment, we have to educate the voters, especially in the rural area, that the boundaries are being aligned on particular ethnic and voting preferences. So that is the only way I could think at this present moment, is to use the power of the voters, first in Sarawak in 2016 state election, later the whole country, to punish EC for these redelineation efforts. Could you comment more about that?
Okay, second question from Bhagwan.
You know, you started the conversation about Mahathir's successful strategy until 2005 and abandoned. My question is, why was it abandoned? And secondly, why is Mahathir backing forces like Perkasa, which fundamentally opposed to his strategy? And the third part of the question is that Kit Siang has recently renewed a call for a new coalition. Was this meant for Mahathir's ears?
I think Bhagwan has stolen my thunder there. Well, part of that Mahathir's, how serious and dangerous Mahathir's involvement in this destabilizing Najib's VN government, and what is DAP's strategy in this matter? And the second part is, it is thought that over 40%, or a lot of people anyway, of the population is excluded from political, social, and economic conversations. And these exclusions have led to a decrease in the level of security and other undesirable outcomes among the riot with innocent Malaysians in the region. What is currently planned to include this vast majority, or not significant amount, I call it 40% of the population, in political, social, and economic conversations?
Okay. We are very concerned of the gerrymandering processes, but for instance, in Sarawak, how do you educate voters who are earning, say, 200 ringgit a month, yes, we can try, and there are many ways we try, but it will not take the form of a lecture or even media discussions, because some of them have no access to the media. The DAP has started this Impian Sabah, Impian Sarawak project by doing small projects, small infrastructure projects, which we have never ventured into. We have always maintained that infrastructure work is government's responsibility, is not the opposition's business to do anything about it. But I think we're taking a new approach in order to let them feel the importance of having an alternative party. We're back to something very basic. The voters' education there is back to something very, very basic, but maybe fundamental. That is to educate them that there are alternatives. It's to that bare minimum. And the benefits of having an alternative party, having a credible alternative to the government, and by doing so, forcing the government to respond to public pressure, public demand, is to that bare minimum. I think we have some successes. I don't know how far we have gone in that project, but we have seen people who suddenly say, oh yeah, it's good to have an opposition party to force the government to do what we want. Now, whether that amounts to voting for us eventually, I'm not sure. But I mean, it will take time. But that is where educating the voters means to us at the moment. I think this is also something that we have done over the last 10, 15 years in the peninsula. It's just to start telling people that there can be a different government, not UMNO. Even that is difficult, it took so long. But now I think more and more people think that, oh, it's okay, we can have a different government. At least we want a strong opposition. Today, even if you ask the Malays in Johor, who are overwhelmingly supportive of UMNO, you ask them, do you want a strong opposition? In polls, it shows that Malays in Johor support a strong opposition. But do you want UMNO to replace? Not at the moment. That is for Malays in Johor. So I think it's a difficult process, but I think it's a linear process in many ways. Once you accept the idea that a strong opposition is good, the next logical step is to accept that, yeah, if this opposition perform well, then we don't mind giving them a chance. And once you give them a chance, then you move to the next level. But to educate them about gerrymandering and how gerrymandering is relevant to them, possible, but it takes multiple forms. Maybe I can bring back to what happened to Bersih. Bersih started as a project in a very strange way in 2005. In 2005, that was after the 2004 election, the three opposition party thought that many people felt that there was no more hope in Malaysia. Out of 222 seats, the opposition then had a combined seats of 19. Not even 20. 2004. Patla won 91% of the seats and 64% of the vote. None in the opposition actually saw 2008 coming. So, but in 2005, some leaders say, let's sit down together. Let's see whether we can find some common ground. And after a secret meeting in Port Dickson over 3 days, we decided that the electoral reform was the common ground, the bare minimum. And we wanted to work on electoral reform. Interestingly, when you look back, history is full of accidents strange occurrence. I was in that meeting and I was serving as a secretary. One of the mornings when I came out from my hotel room, there was the Star. And the Star front page, Hishamuddin waving to Chris. when I say there was a break in that history, but that part of history, when the opposition were trying to have a secret meeting, trying to form some form of coalition with minimalist common agenda, UMNO actually broke their dominance of multi-ethnic coalition. So birthday was an experience that you can actually slowly build something, and if once you build something, it takes its own life. It moves with when more and more people share the ideas, it may fly. And back to the questions of why Mahathir abandoned it. Well, by 2005, Mahathir was no longer in government. By 2005, after winning all the seats, UMNO thought that it was invincible. UMNO thought that there would not be opposition anymore in the country. That they have finally reached permanent dominance. That was 2005. That was the sentiment in 2005. In UMNO, they felt that, well, we have reached permanent dominance and we can do whatever we like. But it was also partly a response to Abdullah Badawi's weak leadership. A month before the 2005 UMNO assembly, Mahathir launched his first attack against Rafida Aziz. That was 2005. It was only a year later, in 2006, that Mahathir attacked Patla directly. So in a way, I think they were also trying to find legitimacy. UMNO was trying to find its relevance after winning so many seats, and UMNO was also trying to find a way to respond to Mahathir's critique at that point of time. And so they abandoned it. But of course, the other possibility was because no one was running the show. Patla was not running the show, it was on autopilot mode, and this was a natural instincts of some people who advised Hishamuddin. But surprisingly, Hishamuddin now is seen as the most multi-ethnic prime ministerial aspirant, accepted by all. Why Mahathir chose to side with Perkasa? Now, in 1990, it was regime maintenance strategy. Mahathir was thinking about that was the only way to continue his dominance. That was the only way to respond to the 1990 election. And therefore, he did that in order to survive. Well, he doesn't need to survive now. I mean, he's the most, he's the best opposition leader that we never had. maybe the natural instinct comes. I think one of the problems that Malaysian politics face, I think, is that both Malaysia and Singapore are governed essentially by race, or the idea of race, the idea of the biological race. Now, when I say once I say the following, I get very adverse response very often. I say Lee Kuan Yew and Mahathir are essentially a mirror reflection. Some people may not agree. Some people think that, oh, Singapore is such an advanced country. But actually, Mahathir and Lee Kuan Yew both see race as biological. And they came from the same generation. Lee Kuan Yew was born in 1923. Mahathir was born in 1925. They went through the Second World War. They accepted, when they grew up, they accepted those ideas that race are biological unit and not social construction. And I think 1965 separated Malaysia and Singapore, but 1965 also created two one-party states. One-party states in Singapore, a one-party states in Malaysia. And these two one-party states essentially are governed by the idea of the biological race. In Malaysia, when Mahathir came up with the idea of 70 million population policy, it was to import as many people as possible, or to give birth to as many people as possible under the name of the Malays. In Singapore, there is this unwritten rule to have 75% Chinese. So when they run out of Chinese Singaporean, they import from China. And that is essentially what's the problem in Singapore now. Essentially, in Singapore, their migration has become too serious. Too many people came in, and it put a stress. The stress is on infrastructure, on transport, on hospital beds, on everything else. But why does this thing come from? Because essentially, I think UMNO and PAP is a mirror reflection, and they are using each other as the bogeyman. Singapore will tell their voters, if you don't vote for PAP, Singapore, if you don't do what I say, you will be run over by the external forces. Singapore is just a red dot in the sea of green. In Malaysia, UMNO tells the Malays, if you don't vote for UMNO, the PAP agent DAP will take over. No, that's essentially the message. Now, DAP has no relationship with PAP now. I mean, it started as an offshoot, but it has no, it's ends all ties in 1967. But that's essentially the message. So I think we have, as I said earlier, for Malaysia to move forward, we have to leave or depart from the idea that race is biological. We have to recognize that race is socially constructed, and at some point we can reconfigure the identity. We can place more importance on our Malaysian identity versus other identities. And from there, we can build a better society. Now, why Kit Siang talks about the new coalition? When Kit Siang talks about new coalition, it has a lot to do with the Hudud debate. The Hudud debate was essentially, it was originally painted as something that will break Pakatan. But what Kit Siang was trying to say is that, well, it will break Pakatan, it will also break Barisan Nasional. If you follow the news today, Rahim Noor, former IGP, said that if Hudud is allowed to be presented in Parliament, Sabah and Sarawak will succeed. And that is essentially his message, Kit Siang's message. That the moment you push Hudud, you break Pakatan, certainly, but you will also break Barisan Nasional. Because Najib was thinking to use this to buy time for himself. Najib was thinking to use this in order to distract everyone. And therefore, he allowed Jamil K to support, pass what they call motion in order to take away other issues. This is very emotive. Hudud is an emotive issue because for many Muslims, it's seen as part of the scripture. Not everyone agree with it, but you somehow feel that you're not supposed to oppose it. And for many non-Muslims, they felt that this is an exclusively Muslim project. It has nothing to do with the non-Muslim. It's trying to legitimize the non-Muslim. So it becomes a very emotive debate. So when Kit Siang talked about that, he was saying that, more or less, but that letter basically called him a gambler and called him all sorts of names. And that Mahathir had a role in the demise. And Mahathir was almost arrested under ISA for that letter. And Mahathir was sacked from UMNO for that letter, and eventually he became a hero also because of that letter. Mahathir became deputy prime minister in January 1976 when Razak passed away, and Mahathir became deputy prime minister in March 1976. Razak passed away in January 1976, and 2 months later, Hussein On appointed Mahathir as deputy prime minister among three choices. Actually, Hussein Al wanted Ghazali Shafi, but Ghazali Shafi was not one of the vice presidents. So he was left with Tunku Razali. Musaitan was not even that. Tunku Razali, Ghaffar Baba, and Mahathir. And Hussein Al eventually chose Mahathir. One of the reasons was that Tunku Razali thought he was too young. He was not married, and he thought he was not. He can wait for a few years, and Mahathir eventually will crash, and Tunku Razali can get the position. But eventually, it was a very long wait, and Razali still think that he has a chance this time. So, yeah, why I come back to 76 was because in the 1978 party election, Mahathir was behind a contest against Husin On's presidency in UMNO. There was a guy who was by the name of Sulaiman Palestine. Sulaiman Palestine was a former Penang State Assembly speaker, and he contested against Husin On, and there was the first contest in UMNO for presidency, and he got about 25% of vote. That was enough to send the signal to Husin On that he would be defeated next round. And Husin On resigned before the next party election came. Mahathir has a hand in the downfall of Baatlah. And now Najib. And Mahathir has reinvented himself. Over the last 10-12 years, if you follow Mahathir's writing, he has really reinvented himself. He's now a more effective opposition leader than anyone else. And whatever we say, he put it in a blog that brings together whatever we say, and it's very effective. Now everyone on the ground, my friend was telling me, even in the kampung, people asking, not just one MDB, now Altatuya. Now this is for the first time. Mahathir has stayed clear of the Mongolian case all the while. Now, the Mongolian case happened in October 2006. The Altatuya case happened in 2006. Mahathir has, for all the while, stayed clear from that issue, but he finally brought it in. He finally brought it in a very effective way. So we can't kill Zero. I don't know who has met him here.
I see me.
Yeah, so I think Mahathir brought it in a very, very simplistic yet powerful way that we cannot kill an innocent person, we must find the real culprit. And that hurts Najib, and of course 1MDB, and no one could arrest him. I mean, whatever Rafizi say, they can put him behind bar, put him under the lockup. So will Mahathir succeed? The question is, what is success? To undermine Najib or to put in to install a new prime minister? I think that is the question. So what is success? I think Mahathir has been very successful in tarnishing Najib's, what they call, stature. Najib was only at, his popularity was at 44% last month in the Merdeka Center poll. I've been informed that it's much lower now this month, but they're not going to reveal the result for this month. I think with this sort of result, I think they are buddies of Tony Abbott.
No, sorry, I missed that.
Buddies of Tony Abbott.
Yeah, so Mahathir, I think, will be an important factor to a certain extent, but of course it depends on the internal dynamics of UMNO. Ultimately, it depends on the internal dynamics of UMNO, whether UMNO still want Najib or they want a new candidate, and who will be the new candidate, and what would be the consequence. I think if you are thinking from within UMNO, certainly you are likely to want a new prime minister. If you think of the electoral process or prospect, you probably want a new prime minister because Najib has lost the capital, the social capital, the political capital. But who? The question is whether it's Muhyiddin or Hisham or Zahid. That it depends on how it plays out. Other questions of conversation. In Malaysia, there's no conversation. It's just shouting. And that's a problem. That's a difficult part of Malaysian politics. The parliamentary system doesn't encourage debate. In parliament, there's no committee. If you follow reportings on Malaysian parliament, anything about committee is actually not true. It's a committee of the house. That means they lower the mace and say, okay, sekarang kita panggil speaker sebagai pengurusi, that's all. So that's the problem in Malaysian politics, and in the chamber, the louder you shout, you get more attention. So we have shouting, we don't have conversation. But I think Malaysians are... I'm hopeful about Malaysia because we came from nowhere, we came from nowhere. Over the last 10 years, out of desperation, we tried to put everyone together. And suddenly we had 2008, we had 2013. And I think moving forward, there are of course many forces that tries to break the society, but I think there are enough people who wants to put together a credible alternative. And I'm hopeful about the society, that the conversation is ongoing. It's not easy, but many people still come from a racial perspective, but there are people who wants to bring this to a common discourse, and hopefully we can actually create a new discourse to replace UMNO's ideology.
To follow up on the Hudud question, because you brought Hudud just now, you say in your latest article to the Genocider, you said that the Muslim have the right to Hudud, but at the same time you say that the Hudud fiasco is in Malaysia is nothing more than just a political ploy. So are you saying that the Muslim conservative, are you denying that the Muslim conservative in past does not have the genuine intention to advance, because they believe that religious should play more role in the political discourse? So don't you think that this, because it is a genuine intention of the conservative clerics like past, do you think that it's better than you should handle the conflict with care than, and you shouldn't just give them ultimatum, get out from Pakatan,
okay,
or stay with us?
Okay, of course, I think some past leaders genuinely believe that that's the only way for a better society. I think there are some leaders who believe in that. But today we are dealing with multiple conflict. We are dealing with a conflict within past, and Hudud is being used. My question was, why was the rush? I asked Nick Amar in our own meeting, why do you rush? If this is something that you truly believe in it, why don't you spend a bit more time to explain to the people, why don't you spend a bit more time to actually have open discourse in order to come up with something that is more appealing to everyone? So when I say political ploy, I meant that the ploy to rush it through before June and use it as a leverage or use it as a political weapon for the party election, and also coming with this objective of breaking Pakatan. But maybe I can say a few more words about the Hudud debate. We had a forum in Bahasa last week in KL, organized by Malaysia Kini. And I was asking these questions. I say, Malaysia is now known for Islamic finances, Islamic financing. We're now known for Islamic banking. And we essentially created Islamic banking of the modern time. The format, the idea of the current Islamic banking framework was essentially a Malaysian invention. It was a Malaysian ijtihad. So I asked this question. I say, if a sukuk, a bond, is being issued for 1 MDB, is it halal or haram? If a sukuk is issued to save 1 MDB, do you think it's acceptable or not acceptable? People are laughing. I think we are stuck in this debate that started in the 80s. Before the 80s, there were hardly any talk about Hudud in Malaysian politics. Media was talking about 1978, but I mean 78, 82, Hudud only emerged as a very important discourse effectively after two things happened in 1982. In the April election of 1982, Anwar Ibrahim joined UMNO. Anwar Ibrahim became UMNO candidate in 1982. A week before the election, a week before Parliament was dissolved, Anwar became UMNO candidate. And that year, after Anwar joined UMNO, in October 1982, Dato' Asri Buddha was ousted as the president of PAS, and a new group took over. Hardy was the vice president. Hardy was only 35 years old at the time. In order for the new group in PAS to fight against Anwar, or APNO, represented by Anwar, and also in order for the new group to fight against Asri group and to gain legitimacy over Asri group, Hudud, Negara Islam, became more and more important in the discourse in order to differentiate PAS from APNO and in order to differentiate the new leadership from the old leadership. And we are stuck with that debate. We are stuck with that debate since the 80s. But I think today, it is not relevant to the lives of ordinary Malaysians, even to the Muslim. Even to the Muslim is an ideal, but around the world, even Qadawi is not talking about implementing it immediately. Qadawi talks about social conditions, the economic conditions. Tariq Ramadan went even further, moratorium. So it's not a major part of global Islamic discourse. But in Malaysia, it becomes so important, I think, because of the political maneuvering in a situation where PAS is in conflict, APNO is in conflict, APNO is trying to manipulate the internal differences within PAS, and I think that's the result.
The reason why I bring up the need for DAP to treat the conflict with care with PAS, because as we know, the disintegration of PR will mean the further maintenance of the regime.
Yeah.
So, what do you think is more important right now? To find a common ground against the regime that you said have caused a lot of trouble in Malaysia? Or to, I don't know, the DAP and
I think the DAP decision was right there. There's no break in Pakatan for the moment. But, of course, I call the Hudud debate politics a little bit jantan. Okay? Of course, you have Utusan pushing PAS to break from Pakatan every day. You have Utusan telling PAS to quit Pakatan every day. You have the Chinese press, the English press, the Tamil press pushing the DAP to quit Pakatan. So you're also not in a vacuum. The DAP doesn't operate in a vacuum. You're operating with all sorts of pressure. And eventually the result, the debate within the party, the decision was basically, let's basically end our relationship with Hadi for the moment and see what happened next.
Do you think that when they actively attack Hadi on a personal level, it will increase the support towards Hadi for the coming past election? Because now they say that now, so DAP is attacking our president, let us all go in solidarity with the president. And in the end of the day, he will remain. DAP is actually contributing to the maintenance of Hadi Awang as a president.
There are views, there are of course such views, which is a possibility. But there are also other views that, the alternative is what? The alternative, perhaps, we'll have to be more drastic. But I think perhaps this is the minimum that at least we can
show the kejantanan and DAP.
I mean, you don't operate in a vacuum. You don't operate in a vacuum, and you have to deal with multiple forces, multiple expectations. And I think that was in a way a compromise decision for the moment.
Any last word that you want to say to the Malaysian audience? Something about your views about the media Malaysia and the perspective of change towards post-race Malaysia, maybe?
I think Malaysian politics has been stuck with this idea of biological race, as I say. And we have to move away from that. We have to move away from that by understanding the needs of ordinary Malaysians. In Malaysia, you don't talk about transport. In Malaysia, you don't talk about healthcare. I mean, these are, you don't rarely talk about tax until GST. We rarely talk about tax. We have the highest per capita road death in the world. because many people are on motorbikes and there are many road accidents every year in Australia. Probably about 1,000 people die on the road. In Malaysia, every year nearly 7,000 people die on the road. Well, just slightly more. I mean, we have a slightly larger population than Australia. Now, though, all these are not debated because we only focus on race, and I think it's our role to broaden the debates of ordinary daily life. I think it's our role to broaden the debate on daily life. Pakatan has tried. We've tried with common policy platform. We've tried with the annual budget pronouncement. I think we have to be more policy oriented. We have to work on real policy options in order to show Malaysians that should be the debates of politics. It's not just about race, religion, royalty. Now we survive all these years because there are alternative media. There are Malaysia Kini, there are Facebook. We're fortunate enough that we live in a time where a handphone is getting cheaper and cheaper, and you can get a smartphone at the cost of what, 400 ringgit now.
Before GST or
So I'm hopeful, but I think there are a lot of work that we have to do, and I think the current Pakatan leadership is not sufficient enough. We need more people to come in. I really see that there is a need for more people to join various party to play a role, and I do hope that this will be like 99, that a realignment will happen. There will be new figures emerging as political activists rather than just social activists. Now, whether that will happen is remain to be seen. But as I say, it's a difficult journey, but it is still a hopeful journey.
Thank you, Abi, for your time.
No,
you need to clear by 7 and...
15 minutes.
A lot of questions.
Yes, terrible of questions.
Okay.
Okay, I need to minimize the time. Maybe 5.
Okay.
2.5 minutes.
Yeah, okay.
For every question. Okay.
So it looks to me from the points that you raised that in Malaysia, race-based politics actually has a more material basis than in most countries. Here, when they talk about race-based politics, it's always like Sharia law, all that abstract racial stuff, safety. But at home, it's about redistribution of resources. So I will put this bluntly. What role does is the DAP or Pakatan finding that class politics has to play as it realigns itself for the next few years of politics?
I think there is one gentleman at the back.
Yeah, I was just going to say that to compare the situation of Najib with Tony Abbott, if you look at the Australian politics, every time there's an economic shock, there will be a change in government. You mentioned earlier on of the people of Johor thinking, yes, we need a change, but is Pakatan ready? I go back to only one question. Will Pakatan seem to be able to govern the country?
Okay, Praveen and Madiha, the last two questions.
How concerned is the opposition with the new terrorism, anti-terrorism legislation, FOTA, I think?
Yeah. I'd just like to focus the attention to race and language. In 2012, you actually wrote an article in The Rocket saying that Bahasa Malaysia is a national language, and it will always be a national language. But right now, Malaysia Insider just posted a research saying that the Chinese youth are divided, saying that 21 out of 107 respondents said that they don't see the importance of Bahasa Malaysia, they don't see the importance of it being a language at all for them to understand. So, within your capacity as an academic, how do you solve this issue?
As a politician, I
think. As an academic.
It's a better position. When you're a politician, you got one break. 10 minutes.
Okay. The word class is always silent in Malaysian politics, and partly because I think it's not just in Malaysian politics. In Asian politics, after the 60s, there was no moderate left. Okay, there was not. In European politics, in Australian politics, the left and right debate was a very important determining factor in politics. But in Asia, all the moderate lefts were lumped together with the communists, and they were all put behind bar and finished off in the 60s. Not just in Malaysia, but in Indonesia, in Korea, in Taiwan, in Japan. So today, essentially, in all these democracies in Asia, there's no ideological debate per se. But you look at the material basis, there are actually rooms for debates in a class form. I don't know how that will progress, but I think it is more and more important for Malaysian politics to understand how to distribute equitably in order to have growth. Now, all these years, the Malaysian economy has depended on foreign investment to grow and has very dependent on what they call the export as a way to generate growth. So it was investment driven and export oriented investment driven. But we all know that the world economy is not doing well. The world economy is now only running on one engine, that is the US economy. The other three major engines, Japan, Europe, and China, are not doing well. At some point, the Malaysian economy cannot solely depend on investment and cannot solely depend on export alone. We have to actually distribute in order to build a domestic consumer market. If your domestic wages are so low, how could these people consume? And I think that is a struggle that the Malaysian economy has to deal with. How do you increase wages? How do you eliminate the needs for cheap labor? How do you move up the ladder? How do you basically have higher wage, higher productivity, and higher skill all together at once? That is our challenge. So I think class politics, re-looking at investment, skill, balance, re-looking at export or domestic consumption, I think all this has to come as a package in order to have a credible, moderate left discourse. That won't come easily. But I think that is probably important. Is Pakatan ready? Is Pakatan Sin able to govern? I mean, currently, Barisan is not seen as capable of governing. Pakatan is also not seen as capable of governing. We're in a mess, to be precise. I think I would say that we are now in a situation where both sides are trying to find a new way to reach the next election. The next election may be in 2 years, maybe in 3 years, but we have come to almost the midpoint. We have come to almost the midpoint. It's midterm now, and people are looking for new possibilities. And of course, UMNO is trying to push it further to the right, and we have to find new leader. We have to find a new generation of leaders. We have to redefine our agenda clearer, especially to understand semi-urban areas better, and also perhaps to understand Sabah and Sarawak better, and to build a stronger foothold. And of course, we have our own internal divides that we have to deal with. That is the division with third pass. What will happen at the Muktama and how to move forward from there. So at the moment, if you ask me, I think both Barisan is not seen as capable of governing, and the opposition is not ready. Hopefully we can improve on that. Pota, yes, we are very worried. We are very worried of a reintroduction of ISA. And the atmosphere in Malaysia now feels like 2001. You have a prime minister struggling with public opinion. You have and race is a factor, Islam becomes a factor, and there are arrests. I bring you back to 2001. Election happened in November 1999. A year later, on the same day, 29th of November 2000, there was a by-election, the Lunas by-election, if you still recall. At the Lunas by-election, Dato' Saifuddin Nasution won in a MIC seat, a multi-ethnic seat, against the MIC candidate, about 50% Malays and the rest non-Malays, a 50-50 seat. And Saifuddin Nasution won it. It sent shockwave into UMNO. And everyone said, this is the way to go, new politics. And there were people within UMNO calling for Mahathir to step down. So Mahathir did something about race, some big debate with the Chinese group. And then after that, there was mass arrest of 10 Keadilan activists, Tian Chua included, Azam included, and they were put under ISA for 2 years. And subsequently, there was this Islamic State debate. Eventually, DAP pulled out from Barisan Alternative on the 22nd of September 2001. 29th of September 2001, Mahathir declared that Malaysia is already an Islamic State. And subsequently, Mahathir regained power, regained his position. He became the indisputable leader, and he announced that he will resign by June 2002. Well, in a similar situation, racial debates about Islam, arrest, a prime minister that is struggling to regain posture. It just feels like 2001. They just. So it's actually a responsibility on politicians, and especially on the Pakatan side, to recognize that we're dealing with a regime that tries to regain its strength by doing anything possible and by eliminating the opposition. And we have to find ways to deal with that. Race and language. I think race and language has always been a very difficult subject. It has divided the society. But I think one very important point that we all have to understand is that the idea that Bahasa should be the only language came from Indonesia in many ways. Sumpah Pemuda in 1929. That was a source of idea that UMNO still holds to it, that Indonesia is a country with one language, one people, satu bahasa, satu bangsa, one identity, something. So that was a source of idea that came from Indonesia. But in Malaysian reality, it has never been the case, because most Malay elites speak English anyway, or most elites.